Good day, everyone. I just got back from the gym, doing another high intensity workout to help with my ski racing. And hopefully I'll be doing a couple of masters races, like I said before, going for that high placing, if not the win. And so this time I included some deadlifts to get my hamstrings involved, because it is very important to have a good proportion of both quadriceps and hamstring strength. That way you can help reduce your risk of injury. Oftentimes, if you have overly dominant quad strength and weak hamstrings, that can definitely predispose you to getting injured. So that's why I definitely include exercises to get those glutes and hamstrings involved. So enjoy the upcoming workout. Thanks for watching.
Now, I wanted to show you guys just how intense that I felt my workout was. This is a set of box jumps I did after I had some time to recover from my high intensity leg exercise sets. And obviously I did not use the box jump that I'm using here. I used those two on the left, because if I were still able to jump that high after doing a high intensity effort, then it means I wasn't putting forth enough effort. No, I'm not necessarily going for time. I'm not trying to make this into a CrossFit workout, even though it may appear like it's a CrossFit workout. That's not necessarily my goal. And so what I'm doing here is 12 reps at 70% of my one rep maximum, and definitely trying to focus on keeping my back straight. I'm sure I've got a little bit of curvature on my lower back, which is not good. You definitely want to try to keep that back as straight as possible and utilize those glutes and hamstrings, and avoid trying to use your lower back, because the exercise should be focusing definitely on your glutes and hamstrings, depending on your positioning. And then, of course, without having any rest, I immediately get into my tuck position. And I'm not going to waste my time giving myself any criticisms here. I know what I need to work out. But the whole point is I'm trying to maintain as tight of tuck position as I can for 2 minutes. I figure most World Cup downhill ski races are around 2 minutes. Some of them are even a little bit longer, but I gotta remember that when I'm on skis going over varied terrain, being able to do 2 minutes here sitting in a tuck does not necessarily mean I'm gonna be able to hold 2 minutes in a tuck in an actual race course. So I figure this will give me an advantage for when I'm doing a master's race that can be anywhere from as short as 45 seconds on up to maybe a minute and a half. And in the future, I'm probably going to even start like putting some weight on my back, just to kind of make it a little bit more challenging, like put like a 25 or 40 pound weight on my back, or maybe even get on a basso ball to kind of add a little bit more of a balance component. But the ski season will be here soon enough, so I'll be able to go up to the ski area and just focus on maintaining an aerodynamic position, you know, just on some easy terrain, just to be able to maintain that position. And then, of course, as the season progresses and get closer to my race, I'll obviously be, of course, increasing the speed and the difficulty of terrain that I'm going over. But I figure this is good for at least my dry land training, and so that way when I do get on snow, I'm not going to be completely rusty from last season. And so I'm trying to hold it 2 minutes. And so with that being said, my legs are definitely really burning at this point. Now you're about to see, yep, just how fried my legs were. I barely made that first box jump. And that's good. It means I actually put forth enough effort to I was barely able to get on to that platform. And on my second set, which I'm going to upload as well, obviously it's going to be part of this video, you're going to see that I'm going to even be using the lower box set, because after my second set, my legs were definitely burning, definitely had those metabolites and hydrogen ion buildup, creating that higher acidity in my leg muscles. Contrary to popular belief, it is not lactic acid that causes you to fatigue, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that during my second set. Here it is, set number two, and I had around a 5 minute recovery period. I figured most high speed chairlift rides take around 4 to 8 minutes at many of the ski areas, so I figured 5 minutes is appropriate. And so I only did two sets because this is 11 days out from my Spartan Beast race, and so I don't want to be fatiguing myself too much. So what I tend to do 2 to 3 weeks prior to a big race or big event is I'll taper down the volume of training, but yet I'll keep the intensity the same, but mainly it's the volume that I'm going to decrease. And then of course the week of the Spartan race, I'm going to decrease the volume even more, but also maybe even decrease the intensity a little bit. But it doesn't mean that I'm going to be just like sitting and doing nothing. I'm not going to turn sedentary the week of the race because I want to keep my body in tune. And so I'll definitely do a couple of high intensity workouts. They won't be very long, but I'll help keep my body in tune so that come race day, I'm ready to go. Because I'm hoping to do good on my first Spartan Beast race, which is Saturday, October 22nd. And so I don't want to be too overly fatigued, so that's why I only did two sets. But after my race, and after I've had about a week to recover, I'll probably do this exact same routine, but I'll do like 3 or 4 sets. And I might decrease the recovery to maybe 4 minutes, 3 or 4 minutes. But then, you know, ski season's gonna be here soon enough, and so I'll be getting time on the snow. So my dry land training is gonna kind of shift to more of just developing more of just that raw strength, like doing fewer reps in my sets, along with kind of maintaining my upper body mass. And so with that being said, you'll notice that when I do finally get to my box jump set, that I decide to even go to a lower box jump. And I did 10 on the lowest one before I did 10 more on the one that I had used on my first set. I figured that if I was able to jump on to that box jump that I used after my first set, then I wasn't putting forth enough effort. And as a matter of fact, I've actually learned something recently that we really do not ever use 100% of our muscle. Like, let's say you're doing leg press and you think that you're giving 100%, you're activating 100% of your muscle. As a matter of fact, you might only be actually activating only 75 to around 85% of your maximum. And those who are actually more naturally talented in strength or power can actually probably activate more of their muscle, maybe upwards of 90%. And so it's kind of interesting that those who can actually activate a greater percentage of their muscle compared to others, it might be an indication that that could be a determinant in who becomes like really good at like power sports or like sprinting sports, like, you know, the 100 meter sprint or like powerlifting. I kind of found that interesting. I thought I'd just throw that in there in this video just because of some of the interesting stuff that you learn in graduate school. And so yeah, it's when you say you're going 100%, your body is really not going 100%. It sounds odd to say that, but so it's like, really, it's like, am I going 100% here? It's like, I may think I'm going 100%, but put it this way, I'm putting forth enough effort that I'm having difficulty getting in these box jumps, as you can definitely tell from the opening of this video, how I was kind of making it look effortless on that box jump that was even higher than the one I'm using here. So you can definitely try this workout, or you can add some variation to it. But I figure it's just another way to kind of show you guys my training routine and my journey to compete in the Winter Olympic Games and Alpine Downhill Ski Racing.
That's high intensity Alpine downhill ski race training.